السلام عليكم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. فقد قال الله تعالى في القرآن الكريم: قل هل يستوي الذين يعلمون والذين لا يعلمون، وقال إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء، وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: من يرد الله به خيرا يفقهه في الدين، وقال من خرج في طلب العلم فهو في سبيل الله حتى يرجع. يا ربي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم، هو الحبيب الذي ترجى شفاعته لكل هول من الأهوال مقتحم. Before I begin to translate the ayats I've just mentioned and the hadith I've just mentioned from of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I just want everyone to ponder upon what the weight of these words are. I've mentioned the Quran, I've mentioned the hadith. Two things upon which Islam is based upon, two things from which laws of our divine religion are based upon, two things which we base our life around, two things which are fundamental to every single one of us, whether going to the shop, whether living daily, whether going to work, whether going to university, whether going to college, whether being in madaris, etc. These are the words of Allah and these are the words of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Many a time people mention Quran, people mention hadith in their bayan, and people think, what's the point? I don't understand what he's on about. He's just saying this Quran, he's just saying this hadith, he's just saying this. And I'm telling you, these are the words of Allah. As a Muslim, we believe this Quran to be the words of Allah. So if Allah Himself is saying, then we can't deny anything. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the hadith I will mention are all sahih, meaning that they are all firmly established hadith in the book of hadith by Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim, famous scholars in Islam. Now, the reason for telling you this is that today there's so much controversy within knowledge itself. Some people say this is da'if, this is a weak hadith, this ayat of the Quran means this, this ayat of the Quran means this. There are contradicting interpretations of the Quran. However, the ayat that I've chosen today and the hadith that I've chosen today are quite self-explanatory. Now, the first Quran ayat that I mentioned was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself is saying that, say, O Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, can those who have knowledge and those who do not be equal? And the second ayah of that I mentioned of the Quran was, indeed those who fear Allah from amongst his bondsmen are the scholars, the ulama. Now, referring to the first ayah of the Quran, that can those who have knowledge and those who do not be equal? What this means is not that there's the people who have knowledge, the ulama, the fuqaha, etc., that they are some kind of superior race below, above the normal people. What this means is that they have been guided into light. Knowledge is nur, knowledge is light. They have been guided, they are out of darkness. Now, if you make a similarity between one person in darkness and one person in light, if a person is in a tunnel and he's going in a dark tunnel, he can't see anything, he can't find his way. Then you have a person who has a light in the center of the tunnel, in another tunnel. He can find his way easily, the light is there. Now if you make a comparison between these two people, are they equal? No, they're not. One will be misguided and the other one will surely be guided. Now what Allah is saying as well in this ayat is, yes, there is some kind of special rank, a special blessing given to the ulama. Today that is not respected by the normal people, by people who are not alim. Rather they are rejected, degraded. Ulama have such a high status. Allah Himself said in the Quran, as I've just said, هَلْ يَسْتَوِ الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Can those who have knowledge and those who do not be equal? Allah is saying this, and it's not a question. Allah is just making a point that those who have knowledge and those who do not have knowledge are not equal. They will never be, because one is in light and one is not in light. And those in light have been chosen to guide those not in light. As it comes in Surah Tawbah as well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that to send a group forth from each of them to seek knowledge and then send them back so that they may abstain from evil, so that make others abstain from evil also. In the Quran, the guide given to us as people is given again. that send forth people in the Quran actually comes as circles of community. Send one from those circles. It's been translated by Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma as that these circles being one person from each community at least to go out in the path of knowledge to guide the rest of the people. This is Fardhu Kifaya. The meaning of Fardhu Kifaya is that one person will take the responsibility of the whole community to do this thing. Now here I'm talking about the responsibility of seeking knowledge. Today preference is put upon sending youngsters to colleges, to universities, sending them to get good jobs to become a lawyer, a barrister, a doctor, a dentist, a surgeon, etc. Why? My son's a lawyer. My daughter's a lawyer. My daughter's a doctor. My son's a doctor. My son's an alim. Oh, that's nice. Today, no emphasis is put on this knowledge. You send children to madrasa. When they're 16, they have GCSEs. Oh, they're finished now. They've faked one once. They've been to the fun once or twice. They're finished now. That's it. What about when the time comes when they're 20 years old? They have their own children. Their children ask them questions about Islam. And they can't answer their own children. What about the time comes when they have questions themselves they want answered? About Allah, about Islam, about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, about the Sahaba. When people come to them saying, Islam says this, Islam says this, Islam does not say this, Islam does not say this. And all the person says, I listened to the Muntab when I was in madrasa sitting at the front. I don't know. And then people get diverted. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Talab al-ilm bi fariidun ala kulli muslim wa muslimah. The quest, the search for knowledge is compulsory upon every man and woman, every Muslim man and every Muslim woman. Now, farz, the word farz, I'm going to translate this properly for you. It's very important. The word farz means compulsory. There is no doubting it. Now, as I said before at the beginning of the bayan, was that something that Allah has said, we can't deny it. Something that is sahih, that is firmly established by the scholars of our time, our great scholars, from the our pious predecessors, Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim. These hadiths cannot be doubted either. Now the hadith that I just mentioned is, the search of knowledge is compulsory upon every Muslim, and every Muslim man and every Muslim woman. Now, the farz, it means compulsory. Now here it does not say that it is compulsory to go and seek worldly knowledge, scientific knowledge. I am not doubting that it's the knowledge for a Muslim, the knowledge that is compulsory upon a Muslim to seek is scientific knowledge, is worldly knowledge, is law, is medicine. No. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, the knowledge that you must seek is that knowledge that will be sufficient for you to live your life as a true Muslim. So many people do not know the masalas of the masail of salah, the masail of transacting. So many people are businessmen here, sitting here right in front of me. So many of you are businessmen. Yet, I guarantee most of you do not know the correct masail regarding transactions, regarding zakah, regarding hajj. This is when you do qadr of ulama. This is when you value the ulama. When you have a problem, when you do not know something, that's when you come to an alim. That's when you come to his feet and say, please, I need help. When you have your personal problems and you need something doing, someone's wife has run away, someone's child is doing this or that and that, that's when you come to the ulama, that's when you need help. When you don't understand the Messiah yourself, when you don't understand what you're doing in Islam, when you make a mistake, that is when you value the ulama. The knowledge that you should seek is compulsory upon yourself. For you to suffice upon this amount of knowledge, it's not sufficient. Do you need some great people to do here, if this happens, if that happens, etc. You need to be there. Then what do you do? The word farz here means that every person should seek knowledge for their own self. Knowledge is light, as I said before, that one person is in light and one person is in darkness. Knowledge is that light. The word knowledge, ilm, has been mentioned in the Quran 856 times. 856 times. I'll say it one more time. 856 times. Ilm. The word ilm can be translated as knowledge, as hikmah, as guidance, as wisdom. But here, the point I'm trying to make is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given such a reference, such preference to the word, to knowledge, Sha'in that is mentioned in the Quran 856 times. The Quran, our book, our thing by which we live our life, our day-to-day life, the thing which we believe in totally. Allah, in that book, in that very same book, in that Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned the word ilm 856 times. Just ponder on it a second, how important that is. So now what about those who have knowledge? What about knowledge itself? How important is knowledge itself? If Allah himself is mentioning 856 times, how important is knowledge itself? How important is it to seek it? The second ayah that I mentioned of the Quran was إِنَّمَا يَشَى اللَّهُ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. That those of Allah, those who fear Allah of his bondsmen, are the scholars, the ulama. Now Hazrat Ibn Abbas has stated that the ulama, they are those, they are not just scholars here. I'm not just saying that only alims are those who fear Allah, astaghfirullah, I'm not saying that. What I'm trying to say is that Hazrat Ibn Abbas says that the ulama are those who ponder upon Allah's creation, who look around them and use their intellect to look around them and see that the trees, how beautiful they are, the sky, this hasn't come from nothing. This hasn't been created for nothing. They are those who know the attributes of Allah, who know Allah's majesty, who know Allah's power, who know Allah's magnificence. And the person who knows Allah the most, he is the one who fears Allah the most. Stated by Hazrat Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. And Hazrat Ibn Abbas is not just any old Sahaba. He is Sayyid al-Mufassireen, the leader of the commentators of the Quran. Now, there's another hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that I mentioned before. مَنْ خَرَجَ فِي طَلَبِ الْعِلْمِ فَهُوَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ حَتَّى يَرْجِعِ. Now, this is to encourage the youngsters, even the elders. This is not just about Alim class. I am not just a fool talking about going into Alim class, going into Madaris, going into Darul Uloom. I am talking about seeking knowledge for yourself, whether reading a book, an English book, an Urdu book, a Gujarati book, a Bengali book, whatever book it may be. If it will guide you in some way, if it will benefit in you some way, whether it will give you a little piece of knowledge, then subhanAllah, you are achieving your aim. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said that he who steps out onto the path of knowledge, then he is in the path of Allah until he returns. Now, there are many paths of Allah, but what this is saying is not, you don't have to go out of your home to go seek knowledge. You don't have to go out of your locality to seek knowledge. Simply have to seek knowledge that lies within. Hazrat Mufti Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayhi, the famous father of Mufti Shafi'i Uthmani, has said, there are two conditions to make someone a talib ilm, a seeker of knowledge. The first is that he has the thirst to seek knowledge. He truly from his heart, it begins with intention. There's a hadith, a very famous hadith, إِنَّمَا الْعَمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاكِ, that indeed all things are judged according to their intention. First of all, correct our intention in anything we do. Talking to all of the students here, anyone here, everyone, whatever you're doing, correct your intention. If you're in Alim class, then correct your intention. What are you doing Alim class for? Are you doing it for fame? Are you doing it to stand in front of these people and let them think that you are something? Are you doing it to please your father? Are you doing it to please your mother? Then you're wrong. It should be only for Allah, the sake of Allah. And this lies with everything you're doing, in anything, no matter what it is. Now, seeking knowledge, being in the path of Allah, you can just pick up a book at your home. One book. Maybe on the until you shut that book and go to sleep. And the verses of the path of Allah, I'm sure you all know. Even the angels pray for that person's forgiveness. The angels spread their wings under that person's feet and say that, go, use my wing as a ground for you. I'll make it easy for you. This is the mercy of Allah. Now, I don't want to take too much of your time, so I'm trying to keep it short. The point I'm trying to make here is the value of knowledge. Truly value it yourself. I'm not just talking about valuing ulama, the states of ulama. I'm talking about valuing knowledge itself. Anything to do with knowledge, as Maulana Imran just said before I came up here, that he had a teacher, that when he dropped a piece of paper on the floor, the teacher told him, pick the piece of paper up, Even that is a means of knowledge. So respect for knowledge. Without respect for knowledge, you will not get anywhere. Many people ask, why do we sit on the floor in madaris? Why do you sit on fatlas? Why is it so backdated? Why is it so backward? You know, why can't we move with the times? Why can't we sit? Why can't we sit on chairs? Why can't we have, you know, computers? Why are you writing? Why Urdu? Why this? The reason is that Islam does not change with the times. Our Islamic belief, our Islamic culture does not change with the times. The time changes for Islam. We evolve ourselves accordingly, what time we are in, what generation, what era we happen to be in. We change ourselves to fit our life, to fit Islam, to fit our life around Islam, not Islam around our life. This is our respect. The reason for us sitting on the floor is discipline, respect. Knowledge is such a valuable thing. The Prophet ﷺ said, فَضْلُ الْعَالِمِ عَلَى الْعَابِلِي كَفَضْلِي عَلَى أَبْنَاكُمْ, that the bounty, the superiority of an alim over a worshipper is like my superiority over the lowest of you. Now this is the Prophet ﷺ talking to the Sahaba. The Prophet ﷺ is the best of creation. The utmost best. No prophet, no man, no creation has been made equivalent to the Prophet ﷺ. Then the Prophet ﷺ is addressing the Sahaba. After the Prophet ﷺ, after the Anbiya ﷺ, comes the Sahaba. They are then the greatest. They are also the greatest of creation, the most respected. Those who will be in the highest ranks of Jannah. And the Prophet ﷺ himself is saying that the superiority of an alim over a worshipper, an abid, is like my superiority over the lowest of you. The lowest of the Sahaba, the Prophet ﷺ is making a comparison that the lowest of the Sahaba and the Prophet ﷺ, the gap of superiority that lies between those two is the gap of superiority that lies between an alim and an abid. An alim, a person who possesses sound knowledge of Islam, whose knowledge is grounded in Islam. He has sufficient knowledge to guide himself and to guide others. An abid, the title abid is not just given to anyone, the same as alim is not just given to anyone. An abid is someone who worships Allah, a true abid, not a Muslim. A Muslim is someone who accepted Islam. An abid is a worshipper, someone who worships Allah, who stands at night in prayer. Now, the comparison between these two, as I just said, is the comparison of the Prophet ﷺ, the highest of creation, to the lowest of the Sahaba. Now just think about that comparison for a minute and think of how lofty the ulama should be in our heart, in our mind. What position should the ulama have in our heart? How high should we rank the ulama? They are not just teachers that teach your children in madrasa. And that is it. Today, preference is given to going to university, going to college. No one wants their child to go in alim class. No one wants their child to become hafiz, unless for some, oh, my child is a hafiz, mashallah. That is about it. There is no true, qadr for it. Today, you look around you and you see that the people sitting here have become alim. They have sacrificed 6 years of their life. And it's not easy. People think it's so easy. That when I speak to certain people, they're telling me, oh, it's so easy, but not much to do. You know, I listen today. From 8 o'clock in the morning, from 8:30 into the morning, till 8:30 at night, the students sit learning. And I'm not trying to say this for some kind of respect, because you don't need respect from the people. As long as Allah is there, and Allah is happy with us, and subhanAllah, that is it, then we are happy. But I'm trying to make you understand that the superiority of an alim is a lot. Do not degrade. If you don't like an alim, if you have some kind of problem with an alim, stay away from him. It's more dangerous for you to say bad things about this alim than it is for you not to say anything at all. Just stay away from him. And the same way, I just like to make a point as well, that the hadith I mentioned, talabul ilmi faridun ala kulli muslim wa muslimah. Let's not forget our sisters here, Muslimah. So what Muslim woman comes here as well, the Prophet ﷺ is saying, the quest of knowledge, seeking knowledge, is compulsory, it's an obligatory act upon every single Muslim, whether she be male, whether be male or female. Educate your daughters, educate your mothers. There's a saying that when you educate a man, you educate an individual. But when you educate a woman, you educate a generation. Because she is the one that brings the children up at home. She is the one that will teach them. If the woman has been taught correctly, if the woman has sufficient knowledge, and in the same way that the teachers pass that knowledge onto the students, the mother passes that knowledge onto her children. Now, I think I've taken quite a lot of your time, so I'll be finishing. But before I finish, I just want to quickly make a point about seeking Western knowledge and Islamic knowledge. There is a difference. There is a huge difference. Our affairs in deen, our deeni affairs, our religious affairs, and our worldly affairs solely rely upon Sharia. For us to be a Muslim, for us to be true believers, for us to be true Muslims, to follow Islam correctly, our worldly as well as our Islamic affairs rely solely upon Sharia. As I mentioned before about transacting, that is a worldly affair that has nothing to do with deen apart from the fact that there are laws regarding it. Now to carry your deen out properly, to be a correct Muslim and carry your transaction out, your business affairs out, you have to have the correct knowledge of Sharia. Now, if you have the knowledge of business, accounting, whatever it may be, that doesn't mean you are sufficient, you are some scholar, some kind of professor in transacting. But if you don't know the laws of transacting with regard to Sharia, then you don't know anything. You could be doing haram, you could be a Muslim paying your 5 times namaz, your 5 times salah, you could be on the front stuff, but when you go to work, you're doing haram. That is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Talabu al-ilmi faridatun ala kulli muslim wa muslima." That the quest for knowledge is farz, to save us from committing these sins, to save us from doing such things. This knowledge, seeking Islamic knowledge, not worldly knowledge, not going to university, not going to school, etc. That is, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it. Alhamdulillah, we need people today. We need all people in all sorts of fields. But feel yourself well. Have a sufficient understanding of each thing. Take a little bit from each thing. If you can't master it, take a little bit from each thing. No one's saying become an alim. No one is saying become a scholar. No one is saying that you can't become a professor in the university. You cannot become a barrister. But whilst you are a barrister, whilst you are a doctor, make sure you know what Islam says about this profession, what Islam says about this surah, what Islam says about Hajj, what Islam says about zakah. This knowledge is important. That is more important than seeking that knowledge. Sending your children to madaris is not sufficient if there is no encouragement from home. If there is no encouragement from the parents telling the children, go to madrasa, you have to go to madrasa. See, if the parents are not bringing up their children correctly, because the parents do not know themselves, then how can we expect the Muslim generation to be strong? How can we expect the future generations to be truly strong within their iman and outwardly to the non-Muslims, showing the non-Muslims that we are Muslims, we are a strong community, we are not afraid of you. This is the importance of knowledge. Without knowledge, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as it says in the Quran, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself was a mu'allim, a teacher to mankind. No, I think I'm being told to finish now, so I better hurry up. So, anyway, I was just saying that just value knowledge, seek worldly knowledge, go and become something, but make sure you have adequate knowledge to suffice yourself through life as a Muslim, as a correct Muslim, as a proper Muslim. So I'll just finish there, and may Allah give us all true understanding of religion, may give us true understanding of knowledge, true value for knowledge, and the ulama. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين.